the conversation ex post facto. Now, before I start, does anyone have any questions from the previous homeworks, previous stuff that we discussed so far? We haven't discussed much. We've discussed only what 19 titles.
I lost a piece of paper.
You want extra paper?
After, later. I think I
wrote
down something.
Okay. So, but it's been a while. It's been like two or 3 weeks since we last met. So let me give a recap. We covered we covered part 111 and part 101 of the Code of Federal Regulations. Okay, we covered questions dealing with what customs brokers can and cannot do, what customs brokers are required to maintain, what type of paperwork they need to submit. We know, for example, that customs brokers are required to have a permit in addition to a license to conduct business in the port. We know that there are various entities that can be granted customs broker license. So if you are the person as a human being, that's fine. You can get a license as a human being, but you can also get a license as a corporation, as an association, and as a partnership. Okay. We also covered the various provisions dealing with the moral character requirements, which is a part of a general overview assessment for the customs broker. They include commission of, for example, crimes, which divide into the mandatory denial, such as, for example, if you smuggle cocaine across the border and you get caught and you get convicted, customs has no choice but to take the license away from you, okay? As opposed to the other crimes where customs has a certain degree of discretion. We also covered various appeals and various due processes that customs must take before they take the license or they deny you the license admission after you pass the customs broker examination test. And it's usually the appeal is done at the several tiers. First tier would go to the assistant commissioner, and as we also talked about who the commissioner is. Commissioner is the top guy in customs. Assistant commissioner is, of course, his second hand, okay? The appeal can go to the Secretary of Homeland Security. Secretary of Homeland Security is the person who is usually, it's the department under which Customs and Border Protection is, and the Secretary of Homeland Security is the top guy at that department. Then, if Secretary of Homeland Security says no, you can go to the court and ask the judge to get a third look, if you will, at what will happen. And the court, the appropriate court to ask the judges, a court of international trade, okay? And of course, you will not be tested on this, but you can appeal the judge at the Court of International Trade to the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit, which is in DC, Court of International Trade is here in New York. And if that doesn't work, Supreme Court is the final source of authority. So there are multiple steps. Even if you've done something wrong, or customs thinks you've done something wrong, there are multiple steps for appeal. We also covered various fees provision because customs like to test you on specifics, such as how much is a fee for renewal. Okay, we also covered the renewal as far as permit is concerned, which is 1 year, okay, and as far as license is concerned, which is 3 years, okay, and the fees are covered in 111.92. They provide how much you need to pay for each for whether it's a license, whether it's a permit, whether it's initial application. So this is what we talked about so far, and because a lot of these provisions are meticulous, it's not really the question of how you understand it, but it's really the question of what it is you need to memorize. It's really the question of memory. So what I ask you to do is as much as you can, preferably on a daily basis, to read through the outlines that I give you. And the purpose of reading outline is not that you can't remember, it's just you put it in your consciousness, so when you sit at the time of the examination, you know right away that, okay, 3 years, okay, $100, $130, etc., etc., etc. So, and on top of that, you also try to do that when you do your practice questions, which I send out on a weekly basis. Okay, so this has been the stuff that we covered, and let me see if the copies have been made. No, I just need the copies.
The girl going to your class today just for audit, no register yet. So.
Okay, well, we'll just, this is something which, let me see, this is. This is customs direct. Can you staple this one too? Thank you. Record keeping, this one. Record keeping, this one. Okay, mm-hmm. Well, hopefully she likes the class, so she is fine now.
Yeah.
Right? Thank you, Ethan. Okay. So, today we're going to discuss, I want to start out the class with the customs directive. And in the past it's been pretty heavily tested directive, which talks about responsibilities of each person with respect to entry. With respect to legal obligations when transacting customs business. So let me see. There are we kind of discussed this already when we discussed general provisions. And what where we ended up is with the conclusion that there are several players in a customs transaction. And depending on what your player is, who you are, you several different obligations attached to you. So one player, of course. Great. Okay, so one player is customs broker. Another player is importer of record. Another player is forwarder. Another player, well, can anyone tell me who the other player is? Косани. Any type of косани? How about nominal?
Yeah.
Косани. Because that nominal qualifier makes all the difference. This is abbreviation for косани. Сини. Alright? Let's see, who else? How about the exporter? The exporter means a guy outside of the United States bringing stuff here, okay? Okay, owner. Anyone else? Who? Trey. Yes, please. Well, yeah, there is a handout on the table. Who would that be?
Purchaser, right? Same as the owner.
Oh, purchaser. That's correct. Purchaser. Who else? Anyone else? agent? Is there a difference between the agents? Anyone tried to rent an apartment in New York City through agency? I did, and they asked me to sign a waiver because they claim to be selling agent and a buying agent at the same time. And I asked them, isn't there a conflict of interest? They said, that's why we ask you to sign a waiver. Later on, we'll see when it makes the whole world of difference when we discuss the valuation part between selling agent and the buying agent. And the difference is if you are the selling agent, you don't declare commission fees, but if you are the buying agent, you do in your transaction value. We'll discuss this, I think, if weather permitting, in a few weeks. Buying agent. Okay, I think we covered the whole bunch. So we have all these players, okay? And my next question is, can any of those players play multiple roles? So can, for example, customs broker be a nominal consignee? Or can the importer of record be the purchaser? Or can the importer of record be the exporter? So yes, I hear that. Can the nominal consignee be the importer of record? No? Yes? No? Okay, no. Why not? Because, yes. I left the window open in case anyone is cold, because when I came in here it was very hot. Let me know. So why not? This is interesting question because the directive just tells us you can't. Okay. Well, think about this. If I'm buying something, let's rewind. Okay. Why are we here? To prepare for the customs broker examination. Some people just like this stuff, okay? But most of us are here for this. So what does this do? This is an essential prerequisite to get a customs broker license, okay? What do you need the license for? To assist in importation and clearance of goods into the customs territory of the United States. Okay, but think about this. If I can name anyone, this is what customs brokers do, right? They assist and advise in clearance of goods, prepare documents, etc. But you all take this class, you all study hard, you pass the examination, okay? So you have a license. License is a federal authority saying, okay, now you can help, okay? But what if I'm one of those people who says, no, I don't want to do this, okay? I don't want to do this. Instead of, I'm an importer of record, I'm bringing stuff in, okay? And instead of going to licensed customs broker, I can say, listen, why don't I just go to someone who is not licensed customs broker, okay? And I decide... And this person will be nominal consignee, so I put him on the documents, okay? If he has no license, and he is an importer, technically he can import because two entities can import. One is a licensed customs broker because he knows this and he has a license from the government. And number two is the person who actually brings stuff, okay? So in case Target, for example, everyone heard of Target, this round red thing, okay? They have their own department, brokerage department. So it's a person, right? It's a corporate person, okay? It's a corporate entity. They have their own department, and they clear things on their own behalf. They don't need a license, all right? So, but they hire people who are licensed, Even though they don't need, they hire them because they have to have people who know this, okay? But if they don't need a license, technically they don't need to go and pass examination and go through all the stuff. So what if Target hires someone who is not licensed to do this and just put them on a paper? Okay, put them on the documents, you say you are just a course ID on a bill of lading or commercial invoice, okay, or any other document. That means that you are going around the rule. That means that you no longer need customs licensed customs brokers, because if he is a nominal KSIN, he will be almost like an importer of record, okay? And if nominal KSIN plays the role of importer of record, then you no longer need this guy, okay? So this is the whole reason behind this, okay? Importer of record can be customs, licensed customs broker can be importer of record, okay? And the reason they can be is because they can be, for example, nominal KSIN, okay? And they can be, so customs, licensed customs brokers can be this, they can be this, they can be forwarders, okay? There can be many things at the same time. I know some of you have taken 111 several weeks ago, and some of you will tell me they can even be the purchasers so long as there is no conflict of interest, right? And that means that, for example, I am a customs broker, and let's say Andrea is my customer, right? She brings jackets for a nice price, and I clear documents for her. So those jackets, I know how much they cost. So I look at the documents, I call up the same factory and I say, listen, can you cut me a nice deal? Because I know that you cut nice deal to Andrea. Okay? That, can I do that? No. I can purchase them, but before I can do that, I need to call Andrea and say, Andrea, this is a good deal. I want to do some business on the side, and I want to make sure that I make some money too, because I want to use your connections. And if Andrea tells me, no, you cannot, can I still do that? Yes, I can. Yes, I can. Yes, Sanya.
What happens if you got this jacket from another supplier, another factory?
Same thing, because it's a similar type of business. Okay, but what's the difference? Now Andrea can say, listen, you are a shady person. I hired you because you're a customs broker, but you also try to do some business on the side, you cut my, you use my connections, this is not fair. I'm firing you. So she goes to another broker, and now, even though I get a nice deal in jackets, I no longer have Andrea as a customer, okay? This is not good for business, but this is a requirement that I need. I need to notify to make sure that Andrea is aware that I'm doing something also. So yes, customs brokers can be purchasers. They can be owners, okay? But there are those type of connections, the qualifiers, which you need to be aware of before you start doing, advising your clients and importing on your own behalf. Agents. Can customs brokers be agents? Yes. I don't see why not. Exporters? I haven't seen this question on the customs broker examination, right? What I have seen is exporter and the importer of record. Okay, we should cover this today, actually. Can an exporter be importer of record? Let's say there is a company in China, and they have one factory, they have an export license, and they would like to bring stuff to the United States. But they would also like to act both as exporter and importer. That company has no offices in the United States. Can they be importer of record? This question has come up on customs broker examination. And the answer is yes, they can. They are called foreign importer of record. Yeah. Foreign importer of record. So there is a special number that they need to obtain from the customs. And once they do that, you get a power of attorney, and they hire a customs broker, and they're as good as any other person.
Back to the question, can the customs broker be the exporter of record? No, right?
Customs broker, exporter of record. Well, this is import importing class, right?
I know. You just mentioned about can the customs broker be the exporter.
Customs broker, I don't see why not.
But when the
so
technically, you know, when they file the manifest from the overseas, they need to have the manufacturer or the exporter in the overseas location.
So you're saying, can United States customs broker, can they be on the other side of the ocean bringing stuff in? Why not? So let's say I am Yuri Inc. I have an office in Shanghai and I have an office in New York. Okay, I'm buying. I have a warehouse. This is a story with UPS Supply Chain Solutions, for example. Okay, UPS Express Consignment Operator. They also have their own brokerage business. Okay, I think they are different legal entities, but they have warehouses and they have CFS, container freight stations, in China, all over China actually. And the reason why many companies use them is because they have UPS CFS, where they consolidate freight, they ship it here, okay, and they clear it. It's one company, they maintain the document and they file AMS. It's actually not them, it's actually the steamship line that does it, but they have the agreement. So yeah, I mean...
Which one, but it cannot be, only the purchase?
So in this verb of things, what you need to remember is this guy and this guy cannot be, no. All right?
Others can be, right?
Others can be, yes. Importer of record cannot be nominal consignee. So, let me see. One, two, three, four, five. Okay, I don't think they have double-sided printer, and I have only 5 copies, so someone will be short-handed today. Who will that be?
Which one is that?
I think the one that without the other signs. I just write the answer.
Okay. Okay, so you will be the short-handed. So what this is the cards. Okay, I will ask him to cut them out and go over them every day. And the reason for that is so it jogs up the memory. And these are the cards that test you on this stuff. Okay, on the back you have the answers, and on front you have the questions. Sanya, I'll send you the email with them, okay? Here you go, Andy. All right, so we just talked about the players, okay? Any questions on this so far? Because now we're moving on to the record keeping portion, which is another important portion of the examination, where you are being tested on the documents that you will need to keep in the regular course of business. Right. All right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. I'm going to need to make one more copy. Be right back. Ethan, what's happening? People just keep coming in. One more, please. Oh. You don't have to. Well, you can. But can you bring it after you finish it? Thank you. Okay. Alright, so let me pass out the outlines. More are being made on the way, so those people who didn't get them, Ethan will be very kind to make them. Okay, so Andrea and Shang, you guys.
I have
you have those?
Yeah, the old one.
Oh, you have an old one?
Yeah.
Okay, do you have it? Okay. Alright. Okay. Then all easier. So it's pretty easy stuff. You have maybe one or two questions, maybe more, right? Maybe more. But usually there is not that much questions over it. But they cover the essentials here. They cover the essentials. So the first thing is the information that you require to keep. Okay, and the information that you're required to keep is generally the information that you obtain in quote-unquote ordinary course of business. And so the question comes in, of course, what is ordinary course of business, right? And usually many people take a broad approach. So for example, let's say I'm doing a customs clearance of something and I need extra information which is not on the invoice. So I pick up the phone. I ask question, is it made out of plastic or made out of steel? And over the phone, I tell them, oh, it's made out of plastic. So I have a sticky, write down, made out of plastic. Do I need to keep that little sticky note? Well, the question is, if it is an ordinary course of business, yes, you do, right? Ordinary course of business meaning any information that you do in your regular course of work, okay? This type of stuff actually came up. They came up not in customs setting, but they came out in a different litigation setting where they say, well, this is just scrap paper. I don't need it. This is not ordinary course of business. So there was a clarification. Smart people came together and they put down that ordinary course of business is a routine activity, which is regularly conducted, okay? And you need to rely on that activity in performance of functions of the business. So going back to the sticky note, you need that. This is a plastic, okay? And later, if they come back, customs examiner comes back to you and says, well, we did examination, and it's not plastic, it's actually steel, okay? It's steel or aluminum, okay? So you have that piece of paper and saying, well, hold on a second. I relied on this information, which was told to me over the phone. So that's in the regular course of business. So that piece of sticky note, if you meet this criteria, it's routine, it's regularly conducted, you rely on it, you need to keep it. Okay? So the question goes down to the, okay, so what is the universe? What is the universe of the stuff that I need to keep? And the universe is actually listed. It's called interim A1A list. And that list is found in the appendix to the part 163. So please take a pen, write down interim A1A list. And it's in the appendix. And please review this when you come home because it lists all the stuff that you may or may not need And believe me, customs actually goes to that list and sometimes asks, if this is a fish and wildlife, what kind of documents, for example, do you need, right? If you're importing, I don't know, a snake, okay? Or a monkey, or a seashell. But the outline has some suggestions that basically says that if your record is related to importation of merchandise, this is the stuff, type of stuff that you require to keep. Customs declaration, customs entry, transportation and storage. So this would not be something that a customs broker would may necessarily have, but if it's may necessarily do, because this is usually done by the carrier. But if it's related to customs business, this is the type of information they require to keep. And by the way, the part 163 is not only for customs brokers, it's also for other entities, which we shall talk about. So, speaking of other entities, record keeping requirements apply to customs brokers and also apply to the whole list of other subjects who get involved into the transaction. Remember this list that we just threw on the chart, threw on the board? Well, it's kind of a replica of this list. So if you are the owner of the product, you're required to keep it. Okay, you're required to maintain it for a certain period of time. If you are the importer, not a customs broker, but an importer, let's say you are a target, okay? You are subject to the record keeping requirement. If you are a consignee, let's say the consignee is DHL, okay? They are required to keep these documents. Importer of record. Well, we talked about the difference between importer and importer of record. Is the importer of record is the person legally obligated to pay duties and legally obligated to have a customs bond on file, if such is required. If something goes wrong, customs goes after the importer of record, not after any other party. This is the main difference between the importer of record and other players. And the entry filer, who can be a customs broker? If you go to monster.com or indeed.com, you type in entry writer, okay? This would be the example of entry filer, the person who puts the information into the screen and sends it to customs, okay? So, but what about licensed customs brokers, okay? There is actually a record-keeping provision for licensed customs broker, which has been carved out not only in the part 163, but also in the part 111. Okay, so customs brokers have to keep all correspondence, all of it. Okay, so if that sticky note was maybe not related, if you are the nominal consignee, or if you are the consignee, not a customs broker, you may have an argument. It's outside of regular course of business, so it's within the regular course of business. Here, if you're a licensed customs broker, it's much more difficult for you to argue, because any piece of paper you require, that you create, you generate, you're required to keep. And here is a general rule requirement which keeps appearing if you're going to be asked on a customs broker examination on this part. Generally speaking, it will be related to how long do you have to keep stuff for. And general rule is 5 years, okay? 5 year rule is a general rule. If they're gonna test you, it most likely will be what is the record retention period for commercial invoice or 7501 entry summary, any customs documents, okay? And in answer choice they have 5 years, most likely it will be the correct answer, subject to certain exceptions. And these exceptions are the drawback records. Drawback is a is a program. If you bring stuff in and you take stuff out later on, okay, you can only do it within 3 years after bringing stuff into the country. So obviously, because there is a 3-year limitation for you to claim a drawback on something, the record period is much, much shorter. Instead of 5 years, it's 3 years. Packing list. Usually packing list is a part of the customs entry packet. Customs entry packet usually includes 5 things. One of them is the 7501, which is the entry summary. Another can include 3461, which is the preliminary entry document which you file. Then you have a commercial invoice. Then you have a packing list, and you have a bill of lading. Okay, those are the 5 essential. You may also have other things which are related to other government agencies. So if it's a computer, right, you have to do the FCC declaration, right, FCC 740. Or if it's the radiation device, I have a laser pen, right, I need to do the FDA form. So that's the additional requirement in addition to those 5 essentials. But packing list within this type of records, 60-day rule only. And sometimes it's helpful because sometimes packing lists just get lost. I do not know why. One time I submitted the protest arguing that something was not dutiable to customs. The customs says, why are you giving us an incomplete entry packet? Because usually you need to submit a complete set of documents. And I cited the 60-day rule because there was the invoice missing. And they said, okay. And they started talking about different issues. But 60-day rule also being tested. I've seen it tested, so keep that in mind. All right. And then there is a power of attorney, which we will be talking about next. Power of attorney is a document which says, listen, you customs broker can do things on my behalf. It's usually made between the importing party and the customs broker. We're giving power to customs broker to act as an attorney in fact, okay, or to act as its agent, as a licensed customs broker, to clear things on behalf. So whatever action is done by a licensed customs broker is actually done by that party. So, and the document that allows that party to do this is called the power of attorney, okay? And there is a different rule because it's a contractual document. It's also a legally required instrument. This type of the power of attorney, different record keeping rules apply, all right? So power of attorney must be retained until it is revoked, okay? Because power of attorney authorizes you to act on his behalf, okay? Once the authorization is over, you no longer need to actually to have it, okay? It's not part of the entry document. It's not part of the entry packet. Having said that, customs can question your authority to act on someone's behalf, and the port director may say, listen, why don't you give me the power of attorney? I want to see if you actually have actual authority. And if you don't have that before you actually start transacting business, then you're in trouble. So once after it's revoked, that's when the time starts to kick in. Okay? So revoked power of attorney must be retained for later of 5 years after the date of revocation, 5 years after the client ceases to be active client. And then, believe it or not, there is a definition for the active client, and it has been tested before on a custom broker exam. Client for whom a broker has obtained a power of attorney and has transacted custom business on at least circle 2 occasions within 12-month period. So if it's in the last 12 months, it was only one time, that client is not an active client. Okay? Next. So you have informals, okay? You have special types of entry. So you have a merchandise which is not over $200. What's the special significance of this $200 threshold to this day? Is that you? Yes, informal, but not only informal, because on some informals you have to declare harmonized tariff schedule classification. So you have to know classification for some informals, right? See, okay, this is a good point. Okay, so customs came out with a regulation, with the updated regulation, where they modified the amount, stating that because there is inflation. There was some smart folks who said, well, if you're gonna cite the inflation as a reason, then you should upgrade it to like 3,800, something like that. There were comments, okay, submitted. And to which they said, no, we are constrained because we have certain procedures. What are those procedures? They didn't say, okay? But the point is that it was 2,000 for certain merchandise. For other merchandise, it was 250, okay, depending on what chapter it falls to. They updated that amount to, 2,500? But here is the problem. We talk about this, and I think I'm polluting your brain with unnecessary information, because customs has a tendency to test you on the stuff that is valid at, you're taking April. Update to Code of Federal Regulation comes on April 1st of any given year, Title 19, okay? So what you will be tested on, your test will be on April 3rd. That means that they will not test you on stuff that came out and published just 2 days ago. They most likely will test you on stuff that was from the previous year. What type of provisions were enforced in the previous year? It was, I believe, $2,000 rule or $250 rule. So, will they test you on this? I don't know. Most likely what they will happen is they will not test you on this. However, when I talk about this informals, and we'll be talking about this in, I think, after classification, so it will be next week or the week after next. When we'll be talking about this, I will tell you both, just to cover my bases, all right? But keep in mind that the provisions that you'll be tested on, they relate to that particular period of time, they're frozen. Yeah, everyone follows me? So they cannot test you on something which didn't come out yet, all right? So, having said that, $200 is a threshold. In a sea of informal entries is a special type of entry which does not require a customs bond, okay? And it also liquidates, meaning that the transaction is over, customs officer takes the money if there's any duties attached, you walk away, and that's the end of the deal. Usually, okay? For formal entries, there is a liquidation period where there is a review officers which sit, go through the documents, they may recall your merchandise and ask you questions about it, okay? And the limitation period begins after liquidation. Well, there is no, the liquidation is immediate. For formal entries, it's usually 314 days, although it may be more. For informal, it's right away. So the difference is, in the world of informal entries, it's much easier entry to do. A subset of informal entries is $200 threshold entry, okay? If it's $200 or less, you not only need, you know, it doesn't only liquidate at the same time, it also does not require HTS, Harmonized Tariff Code. And because it doesn't require Harmonized Tariff Code, alas, it's duty-free, right? Duty-free means you do not pay any duty. You may still have to pay some taxes if it's an alcohol product. But if If this is a guy, or if it's an importer who brings in, let's say, suits, okay, so there is like online business, right? They bring in suits under $200 piece. Suits are usually like what, 16% sometimes, so can be quite costly. But if it's below $200, it's duty free, provided that it's imported by the member of WTO, of course. All right. This is a special significance. $200 value. It's informal and duty free. No HTS required. Why do you need to know this? Because customs examiners will ask you, is HTS number required for the value which is not over $200? And you have to know that no, HTS number is not required. Okay. So keep that in mind. Then let's move on. Bona fide gifts. Bona fide means, it's a Latin term, means it's really a gift, right? Sometimes people call it a gift, like I've been known to go on eBay, right? And I ordered a cord for my computer. I got a package from Hong Kong, it was said it's a gift. No, it's not a gift, I paid them like $5 for it, okay? And it was their duty, because it was a DDP shipment, it was their duty to declare it correctly, right? But they say it's a gift. In that type of example, this is going to be not bona fide gift. Even though they call it a gift, they still sold it to me for $5, okay? So that's what I wanted to say now. You see that five year rule keeps recurring, okay? There is a bonded warehouse retention period. Bonded warehouse is another section which we'll be covering. It relates to the special type of warehouses where you bring the merchandise in so that the merchandise can be stored and not imported. So you bring to the warehouse, you do not pay any duty on the merchandise for various reasons. Okay, let's say the merchandise is not properly marked. Okay, it cannot be brought into the customs territory of the United States. Well, one of your options is to bring it into the warehouse, which is bonded, and label it like you're supposed to the satisfaction of customs or any other agencies. And after you label it, you can bring it in. So that's one utility of warehouse. Once you bring it in, 5 year record keeping to the bonded warehouse too. Okay. Okay. So now type of regulations proudly march into the 21st century by saying that not only original form, but there is also now provisions that allow it to be kept in a digital form. And of course, this is old school. Not many people use CD-ROMs anymore. Many people, many store on those terabyte disks, which have huge amounts of data. But irrespective, there is a microfiche. Everyone knows what microfiche is? Everyone used microfiche? Go to the library, go to one of those New York libraries, ask them for the microfiche. It will be like old records from 1940s, like World War II, if you ever done.